some really interesting matches. For example, in upper weights, you're going to see Daniel Cruz. You're going to see Jesse Gary. And going throughout the lineup, you're going to see quite a few kids that are really pretty good, and hopefully they'll be doing really well at CCS.
I think that we've got so many wrestlers that come through this program that are here all the way on through. Now, this is a special night. It's some kind of a sad night if you're an Aptos Mariner. For 20 years, Reggie Roberts has been the head man for Aptos. What is his emotions, and how about his team? How about his team? What are those emotions going through?
Oh, yeah, I can only imagine what some of those kids are going through. But on the flip side of that, you know, they've got the Rudy Guzman coming in, who's been, he was a wrestler for Reggie. He knows exactly what to do, and I'm sure he'll carry the coach. But he will be greatly missed.
I think you're right on that one. All right, we are about ready to go. From Aptos, and here we go. What are these two young ladies people trying to do?
Yeah, so immediately they go right into the clinch. Camille wearing the green, Russ wearing the red. So right now they're in an over and under position. He reaches over, grabs a single leg. Camellia's fighting pretty tough. They're on the edge of the mat. She's not giving it up that easy. The referee indicates two for red. Possible near fall points here. Calls it out of bounds. Now, in high school now, the new rule this year is you can get back points, near fall points, out of bounds. As long as you meet the criteria of both knees being in bounds.
Oh, okay. Camille does a nice job stepping out of that one.
Let's see if she can get a beautiful stand-up, but to her feet, and he re-dropped the leg down to the mat. Looks like he's working on a bar arm here.
Now, he's trying to circle. Is he trying to just get more body over his shoulders?
Yeah, so what he has now, like I said, he's got that bar arm, and he's going to try to force himself around the front of her head to expose her either to a fall or near fall points.
And Camilla's job right now, outside of trying to stay off her neck, is to stay on her stomach.
Exactly right. You know, counter that bar arm. But he seems like he has it pretty tight. He let go of the wrist.
Now how would Camilla try and counter any of this outside of get out of bounds? Ooh, nice.
Oh, she's
nice
almost out.
Escape.
There you go. She's got the 1 point escape. Oh, she tries to do a little slide by. Misses it, but it was pretty close. Score being 2-1 right now. She attempts a sweep single. She's in a front headlock position right here. She's trying to go back. She's trying to go around. But in the process of going around, she exposed her legs. And of course, she scores the 2 point. Possibly near fall points? No. Does not get near fall points. So right now, she's fighting off her back. As the time, she's going to wind down.
I like what Camilla's trying to do is step on out of it and circle, but she just can't get that.
She seems to be getting her arm trapped quite a bit, which is going to be a real challenge for her.
So we come out of the first 2 minutes with Russ sitting on top at 4-1. That was interesting on how the two work with each other.
Oh, you're absolutely right. In this particular situation, it looks like he deferred. Okay, Camille chooses down, hoping to get the 1 point to close the gap 4-2. We'll see what happens.
How tight is he on her elbow?
They just have it. They don't really grab it. But when the whistle blows, it looks like he's doing a really good job of sucking that elbow in, like he's doing right now, trying to create that bar.
Camilla's got to get one of those legs free.
Absolutely. She's got to get up to her feet. She's reaching back a little bit, trying to shake him off. Coming up, no attempt.
As long as Russ seems to have a hold of her waist, looks like he's in pretty good control of this match right now.
You are absolutely right about it. He's controlling her pretty good, making it really difficult for her to score any points, for that matter, even get out.
So would V. Russ have an advantage if he can get something across the face? Well, she's not in heaven with that wrist grip.
Now she looks like she's in a position to possibly get one if she can square up, and she closes the gap now 4-2.
Nice escape for Camilla. Both wrestlers, as you can see, back on their feet.
And they're both in the clinch position. She's got a collar tie with an underhook on the left side.
I'm sorry, Gary, but I noticed you're trying to get each other's head to come down. If you can get it below your
Yes, if you can get their head below yours and snap them down to the mat, that's a big advantage. It looks like that's what she's trying to do. Minor problem, she stuck the head right at her own legs. So hopefully she can correct that problem.
One thing I noticed about Russ on that one was when she went for that push down, he's got good drive with the legs to come into her.
You're absolutely right about it. She's got to give ground, otherwise she's going to be taking advantage of that situation. There's a little slide by we talked about earlier. There's the two-point takedown. That's one of Camellia's favorite techniques that she has. So right now she's getting kind of tough. All right?
4-4.
4-4 is a score. So right now she's underneath both armpits trying to control the wrist. Time running out. I'm interested to see what happens in this third round. What Red chooses.
She's trying to work around.
Oh, yeah. It looks like she's trying to bring that arm out. Oh, for back points. Oh.
Not enough. But I you can see it right there.
Another
2 seconds, 3 seconds, I think you would have had that arm.
All right. Well, this will be interesting. He chooses neutral. Score will be 4-4. Let's see what happens. It go right to a clinch. She's trying to do a snap. She's got the front headlock.
And that time she did a good job of keeping her legs away.
Yes, she did. As you saw before, he was grabbing her legs. This time she did. She looks like she's attempting a knee tap, which means her right arm is trying to go across the far side.
They're about to be right in the kitchen.
Out of bounds. Oh, yeah.
Now, this eyes group, I don't mind being right in my kitchen. When we get the 280 pounders.
Oh, yeah, we have no problem there.
Yeah, I'm putting you in front.
The one thing that we got to say about Camellia, she plays a TCS last year. Oh, looks like she's looking at a submit job. Almost has it. Instead of going for the submit job, she decided to secure the two-point takedown, putting her ahead 6-4. Now she's got right off, which is what she's doing. Referee calls potentially dangerous as she slipped in the boots. Boots meaning long legs, legs inside.
Camellia's record is 25-10, 19 pins on the year.
And last year she placed at CCS fourth, I believe, or third. This year she placed fourth, just one placement away from going to state. But she's tough. She's a very good off-season worker. She'll be interesting to see her success, I should say.
He was ranked fifth in the CCS Central Coast section. She's doing a nice job just basically saddling up.
Yes, right now she's got those boots in, which means her legs, she's using her legs to her advantage to control them. Power half up on top. She's got a lot of hip pressure. Warning on red. It's very hard to do anything from the bottom position when she has those boots, especially somebody like her. She knows how to use that hip pressure. Did you see that? Where he just automatically dropped his hips down to the mat. She's doing a great job of controlling him with the armpits.
He was doing a good job. Her weight is, now he's starting to move a little bit. Basically,
she's going for a foul. Look at this. Referee's giving her swipes, which means that she's going to score this one. She scores a foul right at the buzzer. Nice win for Camellia.
Camellia continues to show her dominance on the mat.
Oh, yeah.
And she showed me something, Gary, that you've been a wrestling coach, and I'm just a coach. Patience.
Oh, absolutely.
Not a bit panicked.
You're exactly right. She calculated her win really, really well. You know, I think one thing that we should mention about her is she's one of the Santa Cruz Gold members, which means that she's committed 8 months last year. Going into the high school season, it's definitely paid off for her. So she's one of the gold members, once again, has put in a lot of time, and she's reaping the success. As well as Greta. Greta's another one of our gold members.
This is from Santa Cruz, and Eli Gloucester from Aptos. General League 3-0, Eli 5-1. They're not wasting any time. Look at the busyness of the hands.
Oh, yeah. They go right into that clinch. She's trying to snap that head down. Makes a single leg attempt, reaching for that leg. They're both maintaining good position right now. They're in good head-to-head situation. A lot of hand fighting going on right there. And that can tire somebody out, just hand fighting.
I was going to ask you that question. Is this one way also to try and fatigue your opponent? This is your shape, your condition.
Absolutely. You fatigue, you're absolutely right. Fatigue definitely sets in. She looks like she got ready, got a front headlock at the angle. Looks like she's trying to secure a cradle, but wasn't quite sure.
I like how she spreads out. She is quick.
Oh, there you go. She's got the cradle. Referee calls that out of bounds. I don't know if that was a great call. She was still in bounds with a pinning combination.
Yeah, she looked like she was in control of it, so.
Yeah.
Without question, question.
So he's in on a shot. She's countering. No points are awarded yet.
Got to try and get out of it.
Yes. Nice. No points yet, though. He still has an ankle. So as long as he has that ankle, the referee's not going to give up any points. So it's kind of like a funk move, we'll call it. Oh, he calls a stalemate. Probably a good call.
Looked like they probably weren't going to go anywhere because Eli wasn't going to let go because he knew better.
Exactly right. He knew he, as long as he held onto that foot, no points were going to be awarded. They go right back into a clinch. She tries a head snap with an underhook on the left side. Shot. Pops out to a double leg shot. Nice job there, Cole. Yes, he immediately goes into a spiral. Her hand is in the crotch area. Right hand on half Nelson. She's controlling him pretty good. He tries to switch. She jams into him, brings him right back down to the mat. Time running out. And
so we end up on the first one, Jenna on top, 2-0. There goes the disc.
He's going to defer to her. She chooses neutral.
That might be a good move for her part because she seems quicker to be able to go for a leg shot, either a single or a double.
Oh, absolutely. She's working to her strength, which is on her feet. But the escape is something you cannot avoid sooner or later. You have to make sure that you have some good skills down at that bottom to be able to get out. Nice snap down.
Good kick out.
Looks like she's going to drive into him. Driving for 2 points. It takes a 4-2 lead. Looks like she's got a cow catch with that left arm, pushing it over to the back.
She got him in trouble.
Yes, she does.
She can get that chest over the top rope. She might just get a foot.
Try to keep him in bounds. Don't let him get out of bounds. He should be trying to get out of bounds.
He's working it. Grannis continuing to try and get at her. She's really firing through the legs.
Oh,
right
in.
Program has really come back from the depths.
Oh yes, they have. You know, they got a new coach, some new enthusiasm. Kids are pretty stoked in the program there. They've done a great job in turning their program around.
Evan Carrillo coming out on the mat. We're at the 122 pounders coming through right now. They're still fast, but they're awful strong. He's from Aptos, a senior. League record at 5-1, and George Mendoza out of Soquel, 2-0. Now that's a program that used to be, when you were coaching, that was a very prominent program.
Yeah, under Don Fishburne, Don did a great job of recruiting kids, but things change, you know, everything is cyclical here. Yeah.
Soquel in the blue, and Aptos in the, what would you call it?
Camouflage? Yeah, we'll call it camouflage. We got the number one seed and the number two seed. Evan Carrillo, Aptos being the number one, George being the number two.
By the way, George goes by Spider-Man.
Oh, yes, he does. You can see why.
George doing a nice lot of lanky legs on him. He's got some good leverage if he can use it.
Both of these guys look like they're a pretty good matchup. There's a club to the head. George comes back with a tie.
Evan comes in as we go out of bounds.
Out of bounds.
Evan, again, from Aptos High School, record 50-12. He's also a football player, which this sport of wrestling helps you in the sport of football.
Absolutely. One of the greatest things that kids could do to be a better football player is to wrestle. So much contact, mental toughness. He's in on a shot, sucks him up, drives him right to his back, but does not get the back points. He gets the two for the takedown, but no back press. Possible dangerous situation there with that arm. Referee's got to be real careful.
He calls it. That call. Well, you have to have flexibility and strength. If I were out there doing it, you'd hear a snap pop, and that would be the end of it.
Me and you both at this point are our lives.
We're going 60 sets group up here.
Whistle blew. He went for the outside ankle. Looks like he's trying to work the cross-face cradle.
Now that's got to be a little bit uncomfortable for the for George.
Yes. The cross-face can, you know, can be a very effective technique. Very uncomfortable to have somebody's arm ripping across your face.
I like how George is trying to control the legs, but Evan's doing a nice job of just sitting right
on top. George is in a good position to be able to get out and get one, but he seems to stay in there to see what happens if he loses the opportunity to score, to at least get a 1 point escape. And it looks like I might run out.
The man with the thumper right by the officials right there. Seems they're going to get it to get him out of bounds with not much time left.
Yeah, sometimes I think as coaches you want to teach your kids get out and get one. So like George is in a position where he could have gotten 1 point and he ended up getting none.
It's interesting how you...
Looks like he's got the wrist control underneath, going through the crotch, might be working for a possible tilt. But right now it seems like he has George under control pretty good.
Folks, if you're watching this and you can see what their hands are doing, it's really fascinating and how they're working for holes to get leverage advantage. It's really part of the science of this sport.
George attempts a short little sit out. And Evan follows through, nothing happening now.
And does doing a nice job of just staying as splayed out as he can, keeping those arms away. But Carrillo's saying, I've got a wrist, and I know I'm going to try and crank you over.
He's controlling them pretty good with the wrist control down there. A lot of hand fight like we talked about earlier. Giving George a real tough time to get out.
4-2 in favor of Evan from Aptos High School. Evans is a senior, overall record 14-12. Doing a nice job of really, really controlling Mendoza. Mendoza trying to figure out, how can I get to the outside of this? I got 1 foot.
Looks like he's trying to cinch up a cradle. He has, but I don't know if he's going to have enough time.
Right there, and the tap on the official is there. So Evan picks up another couple of points. He sits on top right now, 4-0 as we enter into the third round.
And it was his choice. He chose, Evan chose neutral.
Evan quick on the attack. I don't know if George is just not ready. Ooh, nice takedown.
Yes, he's definitely showing signs of quick explosion on his feet. He's working to his advantage, which obviously has been the takedown. He's taken him down. This is the third time. Now he's tying him up as he did in the other two rounds.
In the previous couple of bouts we saw, there was a lot of quickness on the feet of getting and trying to get around behind the turn of the opponent. I don't see it quite so much in this match.
No, you're absolutely right. Seems like Evan is preferring to just control him on his feet. But, oh, we have a quick reversal right here. Oh, it was a possible reversal. But Evan clears his foot out, giving him only a one-point escape. That was a very good execution of slipping his foot back out.
And sitting on top, 6-1.
Round three, there's another shot. He seems to be catching George in a situation where George is not lowering his position to avoid being taken down.
Evan just sort of like doing a bull rush, like a lead fullback on a football team. He's coming right at it. Good low center of gravity.
Looks like George has lowered his position now a little bit.
He knows he needs a fall.
Yes, he does. He needs something big. Edge of the mat, referee blows the whistle. Back to the center.
Folks, if you like it, this sport is entertaining. It's fun to watch.
Out of bounds, pretty close to.
Yep, but we got an injury in his career, and I don't know if he got the wind knocked out of him.
We'll say he got the wind knocked out of him.
I'm trying to be as diplomatically correct.
Well, you're doing a great job of doing that.
Thank you. It's years of having shots come back to me as a pitcher and ending up on the ground. Momentary timeout while everything gets, such as wind and readjustment, back to him.
And Coach Shane Torres over there talking to George, and okay, buddy, come on. Still plenty of time to pull off a big move here. You can do it. Probably talking to him about lowering his stance on his feet.
I'm looking at Evan's stats. He was SCCAL champion as a ninth grader, second place in the SCCAL as a sophomore and as a junior. So he's really something. And also, he's enlisted in the U.S. Air Force.
Well, congratulations.
Now, after he graduates from being a mariner,
he's gonna
be a flyboy. Well, we'll see if this injury is gonna deter the young man at all.
It doesn't seem like it. Oh, he's back in on that leg again.
Anything else gonna make it better? George bouncing right back out. Time is not in Mendoza's court. Carrillo with another shot, single leg. He just shows with so much leverage to get down and get his hips underneath him to drive forward and up.
It seems like he's just able to get that leg at will, sets him up with a little bit of push, and then goes underneath, grabs that leg just like that. The referee calls George red for stalling. Next one will be a one-point penalty.
Mendoza tries to go for the leg, but I'll tell you, Carrillo is just too quick.
Good defense on his part. Oh, goes big.
Good job.
He was going for a head and arm. That would have been worth at least 4 to 5 points, putting him back in the match.
Not that much time, as we can see, the time around and out.
Evan did a really good job of re-rolling that, countering it, and that's the end of the match. Congratulations to Evan.
Evan Carrillo coming up with a win over George Mendoza, 6-1 in halftime. He comes into the finals with only 11 wrestlers in the finals of their 55 some odd wrestlers.
That's great. Reggie continues to do what he does with those kids, get him ready.
So coming up next, 128, Luke Keyshaw. Guess where he's from, folks? Aptos, 6-0 in the league. Josh Franklin from Santa Cruz, he's 2-3 in the league. Two sophomores going after him.
Yes, sir, he is. So hopefully we'll see some good wrestling here. These two young guys.
Luke finished second in the Marin Catholic tournament and third in the Harbor Vosh Soft tournament. So he's got a little bit of powder. Again, the camouflage Aptos uniform right out there. You know, back when Pat Little ran wrestled, they didn't have these uniforms, nor did they have headpieces. I always kid Pat. I said, how did you guys wrestle in the nude the entire time? He says, I'm not that old. Guys sitting there waiting each other. Each one's firing, figuring out what's going on. Now here's got some action.
Looks like Josh is got a shoulder injury of some type, so he's a little wrapped up. Hopefully that won't hinder his performance.
All right, as a wrestler.
Oh, nice, single leg. Tucked in on that single leg, so behind the two. Looking down. Slips in a half Nelson. Oh, he's not in trouble. Luke is in trouble. One more time. Ryder's trying to get his chest roll over the top of Luke. Can he do it again?
If you get that person off balance a little bit and you can maintain that momentum, then you're able to get it.
And that was a big win for Jock because he was the number three seed and Luke was the number one seed.
That was a fun match. Folks, if you've never come to a high school wrestling tournament, you got to. It's the funnest athletic event, I think, in the Santa Cruz Coast Athletic League.
You're absolutely right about that. We have a good crowd here tonight. People understand, these people understand wrestling, and they are being totally entertained tonight. So we have our first Harbor kid tonight.
Yep, he's in the tie-dye, and that's Jack Greathouse, Marcus Dong from Santa Cruz in the dark. And Marcus trying to get something, and both of these wrestlers going for some kind of headlock.
Yes, that's exactly what it seemed like. We have the number one and number two, Jack being the number one, Marcus being the number two seed.
Right back on top. Marcus with some wrist. Jack's, I like how both of these wrestlers are trying to keep their lower body away from each other so they don't avoid any kind of attack with their leg.
Maintaining good position in the wrist. Oh, there's the first shot. Defended really well. Looks like he's got him in a bad position right here, but he manages to pin him.
You know, if I'm Greathouse, do I want my legs a little bit more splayed out and make it harder for you to turn me?
Absolutely. The wider the base, the better.
And back to the center we go. Marcus is slapping the head of Jack. You sure this is not boxing?
Sometimes it can be. Oh, somebody gets the first one right here.
I like that attempt by Greathouse, but also good job by Dong to just kick back. Now from that position, look, can Dong, if he's fast enough, can he get around behind before they stood up?
No, I think that they would have to be in a different position to be able to get behind, especially in that particular situation because his hands were being tied up. Well, looks like he's got a front headlock trying to get an angle. Trying to get behind, and he looks like he's also going to be working on a fall right here. He's got his hands pinched up. He keeps his takedown. He hasn't met near fall criteria yet. The referee's not. No, calls it off. No back punch. Two takedown, no back punch.
The Greathouse picks up 2 points on it. Dong finds himself in a jam. It was left arm pressed right down to the mat. That could not be comfortable. You think this mat is soft, folks? Good fall. Oh, yeah.
This mat is great. This is. Speaking of Harbor, they've done a great job. Their numbers are back up. They ended up this year in third place. Coach Steve Bausco is doing a fantastic job. His kids are young, so it'll be interesting to see how he brings his kids along.
I really like to see how some of these programs have come back.
Yeah, you're up to Santa Cruz.
Harbor, Aptos continues just to, they're the machine.
Yes, they are.
Greathouse continues to have control.
He's got his head in the hole, swings back behind for two. The takedown, brings him down to the mat. Now he's controlling with wrists under, into the armpits.
This kind of situation, I know that Greathouse has control, but you look at where the wrists are for both these kids, it's like, who has who?
Yeah, at times it looks that way. Who has, you're absolutely right. Who has control of who?
Again, pushing that head down, which, if you've ever wrestled, you know when your head is being pushed down and that neck's being bent underneath you, that's not a comfortable situation.
Peeled off. Greathouse continues to try to score back points. Nice job, controlling him. We didn't mention this is the number one and the number two seed.
Yep, is a senior, and Don is a junior, so we're going to see some good things from Don again next year.
Looks like he's working a power half attempt to the far side. Steph Nelson's a little jump over. Got to be careful. Looks like he's in a bad position right here. No reversal points given up yet. Nah, two.
There we go.
The referee, not only does he give up two, he gives up back points.
Now Don doing a nice job of rolling Greathouse, who is 5-1 coming. Nice step over. That actually gave Greathouse a little bit of a break.
The referee indicates 3-point near fall. So in order to get 3 points, you have to hold your opponent on his back for 5 seconds after you've met the criteria. Criteria is breaking at 90 degrees. If you hold your opponent for 3 seconds, then you get 2 points.
All right. So hence, you've got that official sitting down on the side with that count, one, two, and they're three, and if they see that the 90 or whatever the degree is.
They'll award the points depending on how long they've held them in that position.
Got it. So Greathouse now is down. Don's going to be on top. We're entering into the third. Don on top, 5-4.
Looks like he's working wrist control, put a little bit of pressure on the head. Got a nice little tight waist going on down there.
Greathouse keeping that right arm as far out as he can to avoid having that one hard to get in control of. Don again now with control of the waist, nice and waist hold. Keeps trying to work his way around. He's doing a good job, Don, with the legs. Just really nullifying Greathouse.
If Greathouse could get out and get one, that would tie the score up. If it's a tie, end of regulation, they go into overtime. We haven't had any of those tonight. So this is a good example of getting, there you go. 1 point. Now the score is tied.
Now he comes down. Not that it wasn't already.
Nice job for him.
So Marcus Dunn, though, with a nice job, and ends up getting pinned. That was the 134-pound group. We start moving up the ladder. I wouldn't wrestle any of them, personally, even though I outweigh them. So now we're at 140. Ryan Braga, Odd Aptos, and Sam Hungy. So Cal, he's 2-3, and he was a draw.
Yes, he was. He was unseeded, freshman. So this will be really interesting to see this match tonight. The more mature wrestler, obviously Ryan, the sophomore, junior, excuse me. Oh, he lattles and throws back. Okay, this is a good example of getting points out of bounds. His toes were in bounds, so it looks like he took a real quick four. We got the 3-point near fall, which means he held them once again down for more than 5 seconds, meeting criteria.
He's second place, Braga, second place in the SCCAL. Nice little move by Sam to try and escape, but Braga's the pass. And I think he's strong.
It looks like he's got him in another near fall situation, possibly a fall right here. He's been holding them pretty good, and he secures the fall.
Comes up with the fall, although, you know, Sam might have lost that one, but as a freshman, holy cow.
Oh, no, absolutely. You
know, holy cow, he's going to be a very, very, very good wrestler.
Yes, he is. You know, Sam is one of the kids that puts in a lot of time in the off season, and Ryan is a junior, so he'll be back next year.
Okay, yeah. I'm sorry, I was looking at the wrong one. Yeah. He is a junior. Yep. He's looking over at Reggie and Ryan giving her a big embrace, and that's, Reggie just says so many wonderful things about his wrestling, and Ryan being one of them. Now moving on to the 147-pound Justin Parker out of St. Francis, Nico Vasquez out of Harbor.
And we have a freshman and a junior right here.
Well, this will prove to be entertaining.
Nice shot by Justin, gets in deep on that double H shot through the high crotch.
Parker holding on to the legs again, like reels him in. Looks like he's just bulldogging him back.
Yes, he's putting a lot of pressure on Nico. He's definitely controlling him. Keeps dropping him back down to the mat. Looks like he's got a little bar arm tilt that he's working in there. Referee gives some swipes, but not enough.
Justin comes in 16-1. Right fourth.
In the CCS.
Yep.
Looks like he's got that bar arm pretty tight on Nico. He's got that far wrist and the bar, near side bar.
He's trying to do
plenty of time. He's got the hook. Nicely done. Through transition from a wrist to hook. And there you go.
Nice job.
Nicely done. First St. Francis wrestler to come out. And St. Francis is in the process of getting a new gym built for the time being. They currently work out with the Washington High School wrestling team. Coach Nick Guerrero has done a great job over there bringing that program up.
You're working a little bit still with a lot of the wrestlers over in Watsonville. And, watching St. Francis grow down, as far as the numbers, they've only got like 270 kids, but they've got a lot of talented kids over there.
Oh, yes, they do. The whole school is just, all their athletic programs have good talented kids coming out.
Sir, here we go. Who we got out here? From St. Francis. Again, Leonard Lichtenberg.
Number two seed against an unseeded.
And unseeded is Tyler Slay. He is from Aptos. You can tell by the camouflage. Oh, that bright blue A sort of gives it away really fast.
Both wrestlers in a clinch. They release, come back out. Nice shot by Tyler. And on a single leg. Wizard by Justin. The Hunter, excuse me.
Blankenberg trying to get that leg up. That works
it. Got him up in the air, brings him down. Here's a two-point takedown. That was a nice little lift.
I like that by Hunter. I also like the safe return back down to the mat.
Yes, he absolutely did. A great job. Sometimes the sport looks a little bit rougher than what it is, but it's actually a very, very safe sport. Looks like he's got a bar, working for a bar right here. And he's got that wrist, but this could be a potentially dangerous.
Tyler definitely in trouble.
Bring him back down. You saw how uncomfortable that was for Tyler.
Yeah, it was uncomfortable for me, and I'm watching it. Staying in control, he's up 2-0. We're just in the first round of this.
Very, very tight on top. He's doing a great job of controlling them. Referee watching to make sure that it is not a nice redrop. Referee making sure that he's not crossing. Anytime the referee, the opponent is down and he stands up, you must release your hands from around the waist. Otherwise, that would be considered crossing.
Okay. I always wondered where that release point was, but you've got to have some kind of a grip to get them up in the air.
So if you're on all fours and he ties around the waist, that is considered possible.
Okay. We have both of the coaches for these are just across from us in the corners, and sometimes it's more entertaining to watch the coaches.
Oh boy, you're absolutely right about that. I could tell you some entertaining stories.
The body language that I wonder if they're wrestling more than their student athletes are wrestling.
At times I'm sure they come off the mat after the wrestlers and they are probably totally exhausted. Doing a great job of controlling here. Round one ends 2-0.
like Hunter, yes, Hunter's got the two right now, so Tyler's going to have to, well, he's still got plenty of time. You've got all of the second, all of the third to go.
He chose down, hoping to get that 1 point to close the gap, but he's got to be able to get up and out, get that one. It looks like he's going for a switch. Does he have the point yet? Not yet. Referee has not. At this point, it looks like he's lost control. Still, Red is in control. Now he has control.
Nicely done.
Reversal there. He goes into a quick re-drop right there. Nice job fighting the hands. Pushes him out of bounds.
Lincoln was doing a nice job of maintaining his balance, coming back down on the ground. And Slay showed me some good strength.
Attempts an arm chop there. He's going for a head lever. Going for a spiral and a half. Still hanging on to that lead. He cuts him loose for one. Bringing the score 3-2. Favor Hunter. They go right immediately to a clinch.
Nick Bird again from St. Francis High School, who faced four wrestlers here in the SECAL Finals.
Hunter being a sophomore and Slay being a junior.
Slay is 12 and 14 as they are both being deposited right in front of the St. Francis coaches.
Both wrestlers immediately going to ear-to-ear call. Ankle attempt, ankle pick attempt.
Yep.
So they fight it off.
Blankenberg 19 and 9.
Slide by attempt, by Slay, out of bounds.
Schlankenberg, Colt Invitational, he was a consolation finalist. Now, if you've ever, folks, if you've never been to one of these massive tournaments like the Pat Lovell Classic, there's countless numbers of schools in these
things. Oh, yes, and the talent level is just incredible to watch. Some of the best throughout the state come to compete at the Pat Lovell. 3-2, another slide by attempt, out of bounds.
You were almost here ready to get a pin because they were coming your way.
No, not yet.
I know I'm faster than you are.
You probably are.
Like, for the first two strides, I can beat you.
After that?
Yeah. After that, I'm done.
Time running out. Looks like it's going to end 3-2. Let's see if it happens here. Another slide by attempt.
Yeah, we talked about Pat Lovell. We want to send our thoughts and prayers to Pat, the longtime SCCAL commissioner, played before he got his work with me for many years. So happy to have Gary with me today. You know, he's just working through some health issues, so all of our prayers and love to the big man, because he's done a lot here in Santa Cruz County for all of athletics.
Yes, he has. You know, I'm just blessed to be here, take his place for the time being. Hopefully he'll be back once he gets well. Hunter with a stand-up. He hasn't lost control yet. Oh.
Very tight.
Hunter had the opportunity to score, but Slay did a great job of hanging on. It looks like he's controlling it pretty good. Hunter seems to be able to get up to his feet. There's that one-point escape, put it on the head. 4-2.
Slay looked like he had Hunter in trouble by sitting on Hunter's leg, but he came off of just enough. Thank you, brother, they just got out. These two guys are going to have sores next to the toe.
Oh, yes, they are. They will be a little sore tomorrow morning, if not tonight. Nice shot by Slay. Out of bounds. Not yet. The referee doesn't follow yet. And now he does.
So the referee, I'll go back to this so I understand. The referee's discretion, if one wrestler who looks like in control is still in the circle, the referee can continue.
If there is a takedown criteria, for example,
uh-huh.
Yes, and the toes are in bounds, and they met the takedown criteria, the referee will call it. If they're both wrestlers step out of bounds, like maybe in this case, no, not yet.
The Slay stepped out, but Hunter was still
in bounds, exactly.
Right.
Hunter looking for front headlock, he's got it. There's that ankle, get that leg there for him. And there's a two-point takedown.
Lakenberg out of St. Francis, the Sharks building their athletic program. Looks like he's doing a nice job. Just the weight on that wrestler has to make them tired.
Oh, absolutely. And it looks like Frank's going to come in.
Slate trying to pry himself free.
And he gets the 1 point. Pretty close to the buzzer. And that'll do it. That gives St. Francis their second champion for the night. Now, I believe St. Francis might be United to have a lead.
Yes, they are.
Next year.
You know, that's one of the things, Gary, you've seen a few, like I have. High schools come, high schools go in the various leagues, and this next couple of years, because of the shakeup in the football with St. Francis over a couple of years ago, now St. Francis is moving all their athletics out of the SCCAL.
Yes, they are.
And just like Watsonville did too long ago, and the Grizzlies, leaving the once pretty powerful SCCAL to have to disperse and go into other leagues.
Well, what's happening is as teams leave the SCCAL, what happens is the NBL gets bigger. These teams are merging over to the NBL. And if I understand really correctly, next year is going to be three leagues in the NBL.
That's right. Here we go, 162. Donovan O'Brien from Santa Cruz, David Moore from Aptos. O'Brien is a senior. Moore out of Aptos is a sophomore. Push up. Yeah, for somebody like me who's been around for 37 years and remembers the SCCAL for what it used to be, it's disappointing.
Sure. Yeah, things have changed a lot. A nice attempt, double A shot there. Moore fighting it off pretty good. And he scores that 2 point takedown.
O'Brien out of Santa Cruz sits on top in control. Sitting on top with a 2 point lead, but we're only in the first round.
He's got his hands tied up underneath with his belly down, making it really difficult for Moore to build the base. There's another good example of the opportunity to be able to score 1 point, and ends up scoring none.
Chess game while you're fighting for your life.
You're absolutely right. You have to be able to make good, quick decisions based on the situations. And we've seen tonight plenty of opportunities for kids to score 1 point and stay in there and not get any points at all.
O'Brien's current record is 5-0. Moore, his overall record is 14-13. So he's seen a lot of bouts.
The more bucks you can get, the more experience you're going to get. Win, lose, or draw.
That was always my philosophy. The boys I coached, I wanted to play as many games as high school rules would allow me against the toughest competition.
You're absolutely right. You want to be the best, you got to meet the best.
And the players, and you and I talked about this before, they were there 5 days a week. The three of them were practice and two of them were games in the baseball situation. We had a lot of dedicated athletes when I was at Aptos, and the same thing when I moved up. And I know you did also at Watsonville.
Well, it's one thing we coaches need to insist on is commitment and dedication.
And folks, what you're seeing is some wrestlers here with a lot of commitment and a lot of dedication to talk to their coaches. Quickly, O'Brien gaining in control again. He's on top 2-0. Moore having trouble just scoring points, just getting to the commit scoring position.
Seems like he's doing a really good job of controlling. You can see that he's pushing off the back feet. His back feet pressuring him down. There could be a possible stick right there. And Moore had the opportunity once again to secure 1 point. And comes up short again.
That's where the
Donovan doing a great job of calling the last name. Looks like he got half is trying to slip in there. Moore doing a good job of putting them off.
Emiliano Aragon.
He's got to be careful he doesn't pull a full Nelson.
Yeah. That would hurt.
Yeah.
Coach Aragon, coach for Santa Cruz, has done a good job building his program.
Oh, yes.
And he's up to 25 rushers, and I remember a couple years back, they had four.
Yes, he's done a really good job in two short years, as well as Harvard's done a good job getting those numbers up, like we mentioned earlier. So things should be exciting for the SSCO.
Trying to get, trying to get him to control,
more looks like he could pull something out here. He gets a two-point reversal. This time he's able to capitalize on it. Makes you wonder about the team sitting in. Looks like we got that. Cap Nelson is getting a little sloppy. He's still got that leg. As long as he's got that leg, he's still in control. But once he gives up that leg, comes running out. He's still hanging on. And is he going to be saved by the buzzer? No! He gives up a two-point reversal.
O'Brien doing a great job of just getting that leg out of there. You can see Moore go from behind the knee with a good grab, slowly sliding down the calf, and then Moore says, or O'Brien just yanked that foot out from underneath it. Headed for round three.
And it looks like O'Brien, oh, he indicated neutral, then he changed his mind and decided to go down.
Trying to get the points for an escape?
Definitely, or a reversal.
Now, if you don't get that escape quickly, do those points just sort of go away?
No, there's always the opportunity to score a reversal. Oh, as this right here. Now he's going to get the reversal. He could possibly get the foul, which is good. Another lead champ for Santa Cruz.
By both of those young wrestlers, you can see that I can understand why the coach is speaking very highly of them.
Oh, you're absolutely right. You know, just it takes a lot of courage to be a wrestler and come out. It's not, once again, yeah, it just takes a lot of courage. I'll leave it at that. Here's one of the premier wrestlers from the section, as well as the CCL.
Yeah.
Jesse Berry.
Jesse Berry out of SOVs. Before another ranked fourth in the CCS. Marcus Reyes outcrossed ranked eighth in the CCS. But both of these wrestlers, I think they're full-time wrestlers.
They could be. Marcus with a 5-1 record, and Jesse with a 4-0 record on league.
SOV normally has they're in black with their famous red. Jesse goes all white with cooties right down the back.
Oh, yes, he is. We've got two guys that are pretty muscular. Looks like they both have a lot of strength that they're demonstrating right now.
I'll tell you one thing, they both woke up.
Yes, sir, Reed. Now, San Lorenzo Valley also has Susan moving on to the World State Finals.
Oh, yeah. Yep, they've got her and Ruby Miller Sartain also going to the CCS finals. Ruby, yeah. Ruby.
Yes, Ruby. Excuse me, Ruby. That's why I meant to say Ruby will be going on to the state finals. She plays there at CCS.
Yeah, Jesse, he's a wrestler, and you can see that because he's dedicated his time to it, but he's also a water polo player.
Nice.
Had some water polo for us at the SLV. He found his niche and he loves it.
He's definitely good at it. He's got some good credentials this year so far.
Yep, he falls first in the Winter Lawson, the sixth in the Coast Classic, first in the Apple Cider. Also, the Apple Cider Vinegar Classic. And second in Overfill. Those are three really
good,
really tough tournaments.
Oh, you're absolutely right about that. For him to be able to have that kind of success. Wow, Marcus is doing a great job of fighting him off. Every time Barry shoots in,
yeah.
Marcus just gets underneath the arms and pulls him off. There's an attempt.
Good job by
Jesse. Nice headlock. Nice headlock there. Secure. Oh! That was the ball right at the buzzer. Wow. Just like that.
Ken's been there for, over 10 years. How's that work for Duncan and not really knowing?
Jesse increasing his record to 21-3.
I got Reyes, 21-9. He was third in the Marin Catholic, fifth in the Jim Root, eighth in the El Camino. He says he's a football stud. I believe it.
He looks like he could be.
I believe it. 184, we're getting up to the big guys. Keegan Benton-Jones in the camouflage for Aptos, a senior. Rene Aguilera for
two seniors, yeah.
And they're wrestling like they're two seniors, too.
I had a chance to watch Rene wrestle last year. He's definitely a competitor. There's a shot attempt.
Rene's going for another shot.
Keegan holding him off pretty good. Referee calls him.
Keegan third in the Jim Root, fifth in the Overfelt, fifth in the Lawson tournament. And they're looking for something right now, both trying to just get control of each other's hands.
It looks like they've got control, yes. It's really difficult to do anything when somebody's got your hands tied up. There's a shot attempt by Rene.
Nice anticipation. You can see some of the senior wrestlers and also the very experienced ones that have been wrestling for many years and wrestled kind of on a, I'll say, a year-round basis. The anticipation is very evident.
Oh, yeah. You see, that was a good example of how one person attempted something and the other one reacted real quickly.
Keegan looking to try and get rid of those wrists and go for a shot, but Rene says no.
No. Keegan with a collar tie. Seems to feel pretty comfortable with that, which means correcting on the collar.
Keegan also.
Oh, there's another shot by Rene. Keegan fighting him off. Spin behind for 2 points. And he throws in some legs. On top of that, he's trying to meet near-fall criteria. That action was just so quick and explosive. Referee started to slice, but nothing came out of that. Rene turns over to his belt.
And that's the end of round one with Keegan sitting on top 2-0. That's the one thing I've always liked about wrestling. The score may not be much, but the action, holy cow.
You are absolutely right about that.
The other thing, it's one-on-one, person-on-person, since now we have a lot of women wrestlers out there, which I'm really happy to see. So you get to actually, you're tested every time.
Keegan in a little bit of trouble here, might lose, and they did a little sit-out turn.
Interesting on how far
forward. Keegan's just hanging on real tight, not giving up anything, and he's in a position where see this position too often, but he's getting near fall points because he's got control of him.
He's got control, he's got the legs, and he's got the ankles, and he's got
the legs. Yeah, the scissor in the head, I'm not really sure if that's really legal.
Well, currently it is.
It sure is, and he's getting points out of it.
All he really has to do is torque that upper body with his, and he goes that lever, so he ain't trying to figure out how to get out of his stomach, pull his head out.
There you go, right there, talking about. So there's
reversal.
So bringing the score 5-2. Favor Keegan.
I thought he was in a lot of trouble. The main team is composure. Even if Keegan had it.
There's one point of escape. You can see Fatigue starting to set in.
Reggie Roberts over there. Up, down, left, right, moving all over. Coaches being, well, as well as the rest of the coach can be.
Sometimes it's good just to be mellow. You can think clearly, give good advice, but for the most part, most of the wrestlers aren't even hearing you.
They're in the
wrong world. You could be yelling out XYZ and they're thinking something else.
I was going to ask you, with the headpieces on and the yelling and the screaming, how much do they hear you?
They really don't. Sometimes the best advice is to give them when there's short timeouts like this.
Nice little drive. You saw the Aptos coaches quickly disperse to get into the defensive position.
They did not want to be in there.
Who would? They'd probably either get their own self pinned on this one. End of round two.
And Red has a choice. He chooses neutral. He's going to have to, he needs something big.
Keegan on top, 6-2.
That's what Keegan has.
Now, I noticed that the Aptos wrestlers, they have all kind of gone to the dye the blonde, bleach blonde look, some of them with other ones. I would have thought that out of respect for the retirement of their coach, they would have had the same haircut that Reggie has.
They probably would have done that and had brought it to their attention. It's a tradition for them to dye their hair blonde. Some of the coaches do it. You see the new coach, Rudy, over there.
Yep.
He's got his hair dyed. But it would have been great to see all the Aptos wrestlers go bald.
Yep.
So here we go, round three, 6-2. Denton's ahead. Denton seems to be pushing that. Hey, he's going to get called on it. Yeah.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, he just seems to be a little bit too aggressive with that headbutting. It's pretty blatant.
These officials, and I've watched them for over the years, follow wrestling a lot, are very good. Seki Kaiser.
Nice shot by Blayton. And Keegan takedown.
Keegan Button Jones now in control, sitting on top of Renee. All he needs is a saddle to Brian.
There's an escape, so he's down by four. Plenty of time. He wants to try to pull something off. There's a shot. It's 1 point green because Renee just grabbed the head alone. The ruling is you must have an arm in order to use the head and arm.
Okay.
In that particular case, she had just the head alone.
So that could put a lot of pressure and torque on.
Yeah, that's definitely a potentially dangerous hold.
As I was saying before, these officials, and I've seen them year after year after year, very alert, very safety conscious. They're up there to protect these young athletes.
Yeah, I mean, like, wrestling does have its injuries, boo-boos, just like any other sport, but when you have two officials out there making sure that kids don't misapply any techniques, with safety being the main concern for the kids.
Well, we've got this little break. This may be one of the few times that I have actually seen all the athletic directors and all the schools in the SCCA in the same place at the same time that didn't have meeting attached to it.
Well, that's great for wrestling.
I love it. You know, this is also one of the rare times when all the schools are in the same place at the same time.
You know, even though these kids are competitors, they compete against each other, they have these friendships amongst each other. Once it's over, they shake hands gracefully, good sportsmen, and you see a lot of them talking to each other after the competition is over.
That's one of the things I've always enjoyed about the wrestlers. It's kind of like the no attitudes allowed. You come in here, you wrestle, you win, you lose, you know, and then give congratulations.
You're absolutely right about that. A nice aggressive front headlock. Doing a good job really putting a lot of pressure on him.
I'm impressed that he's able to get that upper body, his almost all his weight right over Renee's shoulders. And Renee doing a nice job with his legs to work his way free.
Renee in that same situation as he was before with the possibility of slipping up the back.
Yeah, but that right now got that
suit. Yeah, he's got those legs and boots. He's got those boots in there. He's in with the arms.
And he's sitting very comfortably 11-4 with time running out on Renee.
3-2-1 time. Nice victory for Keegan.
Dugan Dutton Jones comes away with an 11-4 victory over Rene Aguilera of Santa Cruz. Good wrestling done by both of those.
Absolutely. Even though the score was a little bit off, there was some really good wrestling. Rene did a really good job of competing against people.
That was three periods of intense go after type of wrestling. And Keegan Dutton Jones knows that he was in one heck of a war. Moving up the ladder on weights, we're now coming into the 197. This is where I should decide.
Oh, yeah. Let's get ready to move if we have to.
Felipe Padilla Noriaga of St. Francis, senior. Danny Cruz of Harbor, he is a junior.
These are some big boys going at it, both clinch right away, pushing into each other.
I'll tell you, if they come this way, I'll protect you.
Oh, please do.
I'm not sure how.
You know how? I'll grab you and put you in front of me.
That would be how.
There's one attempt by Felipe.
Let's go, Danny!
So he can do a nice job of push shove and then right into the scorer's booth.
Grab your hands, Danny!
Cruz.
Doing some hand fighting in there, a little bit of head stuff going on. There's the first attempt by Felipe. Two takedowns, scores a 2-point takedown.
Did you have a chance to work with Felipe at all?
Oh, yeah. Actually, I've had a chance to work with both of Danny's and Santa Cruz Gold Club. And Felipe works out with us at Watson High School.
That was an impressive little action. Just over to my left.
He didn't totally lose control to meet the criteria. Coach Steve is going over there and questioned the call.
I think I would do that one, too. That was pretty good. Now, Felipe, the league is ranked third. Current record is 11-5, section ranked 14th, 220.
Not bad. Yep. Daniel's up on his feet. Felipe comes back with a single leg. Red still has control. Felipe still in control here on the edge of the mat.
Put that leg up in the air.
He's riding that ankle pretty good. Guys right on him pretty good. Keeping him down. Lester, so you definitely see some expect to see some action out of him. He's not going to get that easy. Nice lead drop attempt, slide through the ankle, slide through the crotch there. Almost had it. He's in a position to score. No, he still does not lose control. Oh, referee gives him 1 point.
Interesting. I don't think I would agree with that one.
I don't think either. I don't think that he totally lost control. But we're the referees.
Oh,
a nice slide by attempt.
Tried to step inside and that gave Noriega enough to get out of the way.
Ooh, had he kept his left foot in, he might have got the takedown.
These are two fun wrestlers. I said these are
a lot of quick, explosive action going on.
197
pounds. And they're pushing it. These guys are huffing and puffing. Here we go, end of round one.
Yeah, you had mentioned the experience of Danny Cruz, and he's just a junior, but it shows up. He's very quick to counter. He can really feel where that other wrestler is.
Oh, yeah, you're absolutely right about that. You know, he's been on the map for a while now. He chooses to defer round two. And let's see what Felipe does. Felipe chooses bottom, Danny's going to be on top. The big guys, they use their weight to their advantage. Let's see what happens here.
Dove right into his head.
And he goes to a spider rod. Brings it down. Up on his feet. Brings it back down. And he goes there. Some kind of wrist control. He's got to have Nelson.
Danny does.
Yes, he does.
To force Felipe.
And stay in control of him.
Yeah. And this got to be, not being a wrestler, controlling that ankle, I mean, you've got to have a vice grip from wherever.
Oh, you're absolutely right about that. Holding on that ankle is basically control. Once you try to get to your feet and you can't use your other foot, you can't stand up or execute a lot of things.
That being a wrestling coach, you are. What drills do you go through for gaining control or gaining strength on the hand to be able to control that ankle?
Well, a lot of strength training really is done on the kids only during the off season. There's really not enough time during the wrestling season to focus in on strength training. If you focus in on strength training during the wrestling season, then you're giving up wrestling time.
Right.
Okay. So one of the things that does help is the pull-up for grip strength, but just getting in there and wrestling a lot of times just strengthens up those necessary muscles that are needed to execute the skill.
The hand strength in this sport has got to be paramount.
Absolutely right. You shake hands with the wrestler most of the time, you're going to know who's the wrestler.
I did. It was Pat Lovell. I'm still trying to recover. Holy cow. Little medical checkup over on Daniel Cruz Ruiz. Trying to stop the bleeding on the lower lip. We're hoping that can happen because in today's rules.
Oh, yes. We have to be very cautious.
No bleeding on my back.
Yes.
Back out we come, bleeding back under control. Cruz is going to be on top, Noriega's on the bottom.
Short attempt to stand up. Cruz doing a good job controlling the wrist, keeping him down. Nice little rest for both of them. Looks like Felipe is having a little bit of an issue with his head here. Well, he's in a position to give a score one. He hasn't lost control yet. Daniel has not lost control. Even though Felipe has the single leg, you can see the referee indicate that Green Harb still has control. Now he has given up a two-count reversal.
Felipe is definitely control riding the wrist. Again, we got a whistle.
Yes, we do. Referee looking to see. Felipe might have been a little too aggressive going across the face.
These two guys are going at each other here. And we're going to have a timeout so we can
stop that blood again.
Yep. Anybody that's ever cut their lip knows that that's not the easiest thing in the world to stop. Especially when you're sweating and somebody else decides they're going to throw a forearm across your face.
Ouch.
One more time. What got you started into wrestling, my friend?
First of all, I had four older brothers.
That would start it.
Yeah, and they always found somebody to roll around with or beat up on, and one thing just led to another. I went to junior high, trying wrestling, but I think the real clincher was when I saw my oldest brother wrestling in junior college.
Uh-huh.
Man, that was a match. Back then, they didn't even have a blood bowl. These two warriors, I mean, we're talking about 220-pound athletes, vicious guys going at it. I want to do that.
This is a great sport, and you figure this is probably the first sport any of us ever did. Just the soccer, that's the baseball, wrestling is probably the first sport any of us ever did.
And you know, it's very natural for kids, and when you see it on the playground, kids just naturally grabbing each other and rolling around.
Yep.
Here we go. Daniel still trying to attempt to get out. Felipe doing a good job of keeping him down. This is a good match.
4-2 in favor of 4-1, excuse me, in favor of Felipe. He maintains control.
He's doing a good job of controlling him.
Tries to get that leg off to get Danny off. Somebody lost their head there.
Nope, there's an opportunity to score. Oh, three for the near fall. Score being 6-4.
You want to talk about making the, just in the nick of time?
Perfect.
Felipe had the nick of time because he was in trouble. I think he got winded from getting taken to the mat.
Absolutely right. You know, there's Dan had him in a front headlock towards the end. That might have cut off a little bit of a circulation on him.
Yeah. Danny was very quick, took him right to the mat. They both landed on top of each other. 200 pounds legs on top of me. I'm going to lose a little air.
This, and then the headlock. This should be round three, and I think the scorekeepers might not have that correct.
It is round three.
So Felipe puts him loose for one point.
But Daniel picks up one more. He's up 7-4.
I'm going to assume that Felipe's going to go for a takedown to the back or something. But he looks like he's kind of gassing out.
I was just going to say, both
of them maintain good position.
I like how Daniel maintained an athletic position.
Warning from red. Fatigue is starting to set in. Daniel continues to push. 1 point. Backing up.
The referee wants to maintain seaweed moving forward, or at least try to prohibit.
Stay engaged in wrestling.
Uh-huh.
But you can kind of clearly see that the fatigue is Daniel with an underhook right there. The loop seems to continuously back up. I would be surprised. And another warning. An additional 1 point. The next one goes into two. It's 1-1-2 disqualification.
9-4 in favor of Daniel, who's this for Harbor.
There's a massive slide by takedown, which he was trying to do earlier. Coach tells him to cut him loose. Thinking, okay, this guy is gassed. I'll probably get another 2 point. Yep.
1-5, Daniel looking for 2 more points. Luke has shown me a little bit there. That's nice.
Nice attack. Yeah. Now it's time to get the heated here. Warning, 2 point. The 2 point penalty. The next one is disqualification.
5, you can see with Felipe losing a little bit of composure.
And he still keep going at him. Felipe continues to back up. Oh my gosh, match is over.
Match is over.
Disqualification. Continuously backing up. So he throws you in the glass trap.
Out of Harbor, who just
upset the number one seed.
Upset the number one seed via points and a disqualification. And this looked like Noriega ran out of gas.
Yes, you can easily say that.
But I'll tell you what, again, I look at these wrestlers and some sports, I say you're the best conditioned athletes out there, and I always say that about water polo players because they really never rest. They're always treading water, they're always moving, somebody's trying to pull them under.
Yes, water polo. Why? I call water polo wrestling in the water. Yep. Those athletes are phenomenal, great shape.
But I look at these young athletes, and I think very much the same thing. You have to go skin to skin for 6 minutes, and there's nobody that you can look over there and say, Coach, can you sub in?
Yeah.
Can you get
mono a mono?
I mean, I'd look over you and go, help? And I can see
substitute?
You're like, yeah, can I have somebody in my weight class? I'm done.
Tag team?
Yeah. No. This is not the WWF or whatever the heavens it is. Moving up to the bigger people. Or big boys if you want to. 222 pounds. Carlos Mercado, he is a senior out of Soquel. He's 5-0. And James El Toro, Carlos El Toro Mercado. I gotta get that right. He might be the bull. And Jake Platero, also one of the, he is the 10th of the 11 Aptos wrestlers that we've had on display tonight. He's just a sophomore.
Yes, Carlos is one of the better wrestlers in the section. He was one match away last year, but I believe it was placing at CCS. So I know, having worked with Carlos a little bit this past summer, he's pretty hungry. Great student athlete as well, looking at some major universities, Stanford, Harvard.
And I forgot, James Platero is also super fast. So it's a bullet fly.
A nice high crotch to the double leg, brings him down, secures the 2 point, looking for a lift. James did a great job of fighting him off.
Carlos doing a nice job of maintaining control, just holding on. He'll get him out of bounds. El Toro plays sixth in the Pat and Lowell Holiday Classic and second in the Alpha Cider Classic. So he's been close to the podium.
I had a chance to watch Carlos at the Alpha Cider. That match that he lost was a lot closer than we would seem, but he did a good job there.
Now, did you start the Alpha Cider?
Yes, I actually did start the Alpha Cider with the help of him. Some good Lord assistants, Gus Boss, Theo Camara, and you know, we've been able to keep that tournament going and thriving. The coaches are rewarded with the coaches get the apple pie. They look forward to
it. Oh, I like that one.
Doug is the spot.
Oh, that the best. Throw a little vanilla ice cream on top of that thing. Oh my gosh. You also had a pretty good athletic director out there for a couple of times, Brad Hubbard.
Oh, what a great man Hubbard is. He's still around the school helping out, the
new
athletic director. But oh yeah, Brad Hubbard, the best. Stand up there by James, a redrop by Carlos. Looks like Carlos is slipping in some boots, got a power half going. Boy, this is torture right here.
That
is very, very uncomfortable.
I'm just looking at the shoulder and the extension through the shoulders and the lat muscles and the traps, and that just doesn't look fun.
To see a big guy do what Carlos is doing with those legs, that is good stuff right there.
He is a technique. His technique is fantastic.
Yes, he is looking to score some back points right there. James tries to turn in, mistake. There's the fall.
Carlos Del Toro Mercado comes away with a fall. And a win in the first round. This has been one exciting evening of wrestling. And guess what, folks? We're at the last one.
More. Absolutely.
We got one more.
We got the big boys coming in.
We got the lightweights.
Ooh, these are the guys we got to look out for.
I'm going to fuck back enough. Yeah. We did a couple of years ago, Pat Lovell and I were sitting there. We didn't have this type of a table. Just had a standard table. And I have not seen Pat move that fast in a long time. And yet my prayers are with Pat. Get well, my big brother.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can do it. Here we are. 287 is what it is. Justin Torres from Aptos. Isaac Davila from St. Francis. Isaac, just a sophomore. These are guys that I want on my side pretty much any time. Let's see the athleticism of these two wrestlers going the big heavyweights. Come on, Isaac. Isaac doing a nice job. I like the fact that he just looks at his opponent and say, come on, I'm going to look you right in the eye and see if I can figure out what it is you're going to do.
Both guys in a clinch position right here. Somebody looked in for an advantage. Oh, it looks like Justin has double overs.
Justin working on him, frankly.
Oh, it does a nice lateral. He's out on top for two.
That move looked like it was really tough.
Especially the big guys. Justin goes into a spiral ride. Isaac comes out. It's a 1-point escape, bringing the score 2-1.
I like that, you know, Isaac doing a nice job feeling where he could get loose. He was quick on the spin.
Isaac is actually a pretty good athlete. You know, I've had a chance to see him move around the ring a little bit. He was pretty good. As well as Justin.
Isaac's goal is to play Division I football after graduating from high school. Alright.
I like.
Like good aspirations.
I totally agree with you.
Justin 6 in the Marin Catholic tournament and 7th in the Gym 1. Running down time here in period number 1.
Little slide by brings him down. Additional 2 before the time goes up, meaning the score 4-1.
Folks, I hope you enjoyed watching this. I know Gary and I have enjoyed watching these tremendous wrestlers.
Oh, yeah. Some really good matches here tonight.
CTV TV is just sort of happy to do this. We've been doing this for 10 or 11 years, and it's the schools that put the money together to allow us to come to put this on television. They're able to get money from either the parents or the sponsors or however they raise the funds. They give CTV a call. Actually, Reggie is the primary pusher and shover, and they're able to get him. Back to St. Louis, down there does a good job to make sure this thing gets aired. And it's just fun, so much fun to bring this event to the airways.
Oh, you're absolutely right. It gives people an opportunity to see wrestling at its best here in this area. That was Justin with a little, looked like a little toss of some type. Bringing Isaac down to the mat, bringing the score 6-1. But having it being televised, that's a pretty good thing.
We're the only one now. Wrestling is it, since all the other sports don't have that opportunity. So, folks, if you're watching this on CTV, give them a call and thank them for putting this on, because this is a spectacular athletic event. Justin still in control.
Using all his weight to his advantage, keeping Isaac down.
For a minute there, I thought Isaac was taking the net when I got there.
And there's the first one right there.
Gotta start moving. Isaac is 12-3 on the year, so he's got some good
matches. Yeah, he's got some good matches that he's involved in.
Justin 17-8, the senior. He's also wrestled for a little bit longer. Nice.
Ooh, front headlock back trip. And meeting criteria. We got 3 swipes on that. Between 5 swipes for 3 points.
And he now picks up. He's at 9-1 as we end the second round of the last match here in the SCCAL Wrestling Championship here at Santa Cruz High School. I'm Kurt Edwards, and I am so delighted to have Gary Garcia next to me, helping me out.
This has been a great night. Sitting here next to you, enjoying this fantastic event. As it gets a call here for improper starting position.
Okay, educate me on that one. How was that improper?
Okay, so Isaac's lefty should be down.
Okay.
And it was up, which is an improper starting position. Oh, Justin escapes, gets the one, comes back in. A double leg. And he's got Isaac in trouble again.
It's way up on top. And there he
is. Say goodnight.
All right, that is it. We've gone from 106 to 287. I'll go down some of the winners here in just a little bit. Prior to this, we had the Ed Farrell Award for Sportsmanship, and unfortunately all they got was a young woman's first name, Lillian, out of San Lorenzo Valley. In this sportsmanship, not only is it involved, you know, what goes on the mat, but also what goes on in the classroom, off the mat. And as you know, Ed Farrell, just like Pat Lovell, has been a tremendous fixture in youth sports.
Oh, absolutely. You're absolutely right. I think it's credible to all the coaches to honor a student athlete every year like they do. And so having said that, yes, I don't
first name? I know that she came down to see who it was.
Yeah, she did. She was thrilled. Absolutely thrilled. Still going to give away the final trophy, and you know what? I don't know what it is, so I'm going to turn it to the side.
Well, I'm going to assume, because Aptos had 11 guys in the finals, and Santa Cruz had 6, and Aptos had a 40-point lead, that they pretty much have finished this up, but it's not official yet. We'll find out shortly.
No, it is the... annually presented to the best wrestling team in the SCCAL. Looks like you.
When I was younger, maybe.
Yeah, you didn't have the mustache back then. Let's go really quickly through this. At the 200, the big boys. Justin Torres with a win in the, or with a pin in the third round in the 220 pounders. Carlos El Toro Mercado, he came out with a victory. Daniel Cruz at 195, we're going in reverse order. Keegan Dutton Jones out of Aptos, he was the winner of the 182-pound class. Jesse Berry out of San Lorenzo Valley, the winner at 170 pounds. Donovan O'Brien of Santa Cruz, the winner in the 100 and the 160s. Hunter Blankenship, Blankenberg, 152 pounds, Justin Parker, 145-pound winner. Brian Braga of Aptos, the winner is 138. Harbor came up with the victory, and that was Jack Greenhouse on a very good bout at 132. Joshua Franklin, 126 out of Santa Cruz with a fall. Evan Carrillo with a hard-fought 6-1 victory. He's from Aptos. Greta Gustafson from Santa Cruz with a pin or a fall. And we go all the way down to the 106. And that is committee, one of your Barranco from Aptos, 106. She also wins with a fall.
Yes. But what you're seeing here is something that's really, really special. You're seeing all the coaches over there organizing the medals. That says a lot about the unity of all these coaches from Aptos League.
This is fantastic. This is one of the things that I really like about wrestling here in Santa Cruz. It's hard fought, one-on-one, go after each other, and at the end, it's one big, huge family.
Well, you're absolutely right. You know, if I could interject something, you know, I've got this Santa Cruz Gold Club going on, and it's the ideology behind it all is to bring as many wrestlers that want to commit off-season training. So we have quite a few kids throughout the country that have come, and for the most part, it seems like the coaches...
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, we are about to start our World Series.
The kids have a place to go and train.
Right.
And you see some of the success on the mat today, as well as you will be seeing that you saw at TCS, and hopefully at state as well.
All right, folks, that's going to wrap it up from Santa Cruz High School. For Gary Garcia, I'm Kurt Edwards. Thanks to all the crew at CTV. Take a peek at this one. If you want to follow wrestling, it's a great one to do it. Till next year, everyone, good night.
Good night.